One thing, as I look at this social phenomenon, I think there's sort of a core idea that unites us all in that power needs to be more diffuse, more equally held, and that technology and market mechanisms can play a critical role in achieving that goal. But I think what the blockchain community has not clearly articulated is what that society needs to look like or how that becomes possible. It's sort of technology that points in a vague direction, but not what it means or what it would look like. How do you respond to that?
I think it's going to be an evolved process. I don't think it's a top-down design thing. If you look at markets, look at the economy, for example. The economy is a giant series of markets. No macroeconomist can actually tell you how the economy works. You get enough macroeconomists in a room together, it's like politics. They're all just arguing. They can't figure it out. It's back to the blind people and the elephant story. They're all feeling different parts of the elephant trying to describe it. So crypto is like that. We've created something that's larger than just us. It's just like the internet. It's larger than us. It's like the economy. It's larger than us. You have to describe it, observe it, evolve it, and try to keep up with it rather than trying to top down say, oh yeah, this is how it should work and this is the vision we're all heading towards.
I can give some, without getting into the macro of it, I can give some examples of things I think will happen at the micro level that may be interesting. One is, I do think that crypto will, in the medium to long term, result in what I call instant jobs, right? So right now, you can just land on a website and you can go and post, like a forum or, Facebook or Twitter, you can just go and post information, publish information. We take that for granted, but that's a huge thing relative to, say, 30 years ago when it was very hard to go and, get a printing press and paper and distribute information. So instant jobs are interesting. You click a button, you do a task, you make money. We've got something like that at Earn at Coinbase, and I think that's going to be a very big part of, let's say, 5, 10, 15 years out. And anywhere there's a phone, there's a job. You just have a feed of tasks, and you do those tasks, and that's your job. A second thing I think is going to happen is, at the micro level, I think we're going to get billions of investors. And this is actually something that I think is now kind of an obvious thing that's going to happen, but has been under-remarked on. I think maybe 99% of the world will be investors and maybe like 1% will be entrepreneurs. And what do I mean by that? I think everybody pretty much can buy something. You can go and buy something at Starbucks. You can, swipe a credit card. Everybody here has bought something. It's pretty hard to build something. But with crypto, there's no longer any threshold for investing in something. You can invest a dollar. You can invest $10. People put $10 into Ethereum. They've got like, $10,000, like a few years later. Not every investment is obviously like that in crypto. But it is the case that as you totally remove all thresholds, you can have somebody from any country in the world click a button, and in 10 or 15 or maybe in 5, but probably like more like 10 years, just as easily as you'd like something or poke somebody, you could send them a dollar. And you're going to start to see fundraising rounds, maybe not in the United States, maybe in other countries, where it's like a million people putting $1 each into somebody, right? And that's going to be very commonplace. And maybe that's what you do recreationally each day. You spend a couple of bucks doing that. And that's like, it's your replacement for Twitter or Facebook because you're not just liking or thumbs upping something, but you have a little bit of skin in the game. It's a little fun to follow that portfolio. You can see how it's doing. And you're helping somebody get financing when they might not otherwise be able to do so. So I'm interested in this from like a microeconomic standpoint. I think it makes a lot more people think like angel investors, think like venture capitalists.
Yeah, you can have people crowdfund entire countries. You could have people crowdfund a war. You could have people crowdfund a revolution. I mean, the possibilities here are kind of endless. When people are investing a dollar in something, maybe they're not even thinking about it as investing anymore. It's somewhere between donation and investing. It's like Kickstarter. A lot of those projects fail to deliver, but the investors don't really seem to care. Right. They were kind of doing it more to just support the founder as much as anything else.
One comment I'd have there, though, if you did try to crowdfund a war, I think you'd have a lot less war because I think people wouldn't pay for it as easily.
That's true. Yeah. It's easier to fight wars with other people's money.
Yeah.
Nassim Taleb made the good point recently that historically, people who declared wars had skin in the game. They had to go fight at the front of the war. But today, you can be sitting at your desk in Washington, D.C. or in Moscow, and you can launch a war and you never have to fight in it.
And you hide the cost by just printing money.
You print money.
It's worth double-clicking on something Balaji said, which is if you had invested in Ethereum at 3 cents or whatever the ICO was, that's a...
30.
Or whatever, 30 cents. That's a... You would know, perhaps. That was a better investment than investing in Facebook or Google at the seed round.
Yeah. It's true.
700x within 2 or 3 years, fully liquid.
Yep. Say more about some of the... So don't worry, you guys didn't miss any.